Thank you guys so much for coming. My name is Alex Albright, and I'm a PhD student at Harvard. I am an aspiring economist, but I'm also a huge data visualization enthusiast. And so I'm going to talk to all of you guys today about fueling forays, so basically our adventures, with curious questions. And I'm going to talk a lot about data visualization techniques and a few questions that I've looked into over the years to help me become comfortable with R. So the first thing that we're going to do in this talk is I'm going to introduce myself, how I got into R, then I'm going to be demonstrating how questions can lead to R projects, and then I'll be presenting data visualizations and some snippets of code for a few projects. So a quick teaser for you guys, we're going to talk about things like Sports Illustrated magazine, science degrees, Pixar movies, and even the Senate. So that's the third thing I'm going to do. And then lastly, I'll talk a little bit about workflow, ideation, generating questions, using notebooks, writing code, and sharing product and code. So to introduce myself again, I'm an economist. These are some of the things that I look at on a day-to-day basis. There's a lot of proofs. There's some market design in here, some social economics, some behavioral economics. I see a lot of black and white during my day, which is why I also love to, at night, when I'm not being a full-time economist, show some color. So I love making data visualizations. I love looking at other work that people do. And I share all of my work at the Little Dataset. So if you want to see code snippets and stuff like that, you can, well, not even snippets, you can see everything there. I'm going to talk about a few projects that are shown here. And yeah. So why do I use R? Well, economists actually usually use something called Stata, if you've ever heard of it. And so the first time I was coding in Stata. But I quickly realized that I wasn't going to be able to share my work with a lot of my friends who were outside of academia or who just didn't have industry access. And the reason that I found that problematic is because that really does limit your academic research in a lot of ways. It makes it even more black boxy than things already feel. So in my opinion, it's really important to make things replicable, and R is great for that because it's free and open source. And it can be faster than Stata. Just ask my friend Gulia, who uses Data Table all the time. It has a vibrant, active community. I mean, check out our bloggers. You can check out the hashtag and our ladies' organizations. I'm one of the people who didn't know that I could apply for this until I saw that tweet saying that you should apply. And I wouldn't have if it weren't for that. So that's an example of how the community is really helpful. Also, the data visualization options are so beautiful. And I love ggplot too. And we're going to talk a lot about that, and that's going to be like the workhorse for a lot of what we're going to see today. So now that we know that we should all use R, what should we be using R for? Well, I mean, there's tons of great resources for learning R. There's tons of great things to do once you're in R. I specifically am interested in building data visualizations to answer questions visually. And I think that starting off by learning how to do data viz is a really cool way for beginners to become comfortable in R, because you learn how to do things like formulate interesting questions, find and collect data sets, but also clean and shape them. You rarely just find a data set that's exactly the way that you're going to want it to then just throw it in a visualization. Also, something really important, I think, is that you learn to identify like the heart of data-driven results. So this is what I'm saying with being conceptually succinct. So trying to identify the key of what your results are is something that you really have to do if you want to create just a few visualizations. You also get to practice friendly design, use packages, and build your own kind of custom plots over time. So this leads me to my title, which is Fueling Forays with Curious Questions. And I'm going to talk about four specific questions with you guys that I became curious about at some point, and then I tried to answer by collecting data, using R to shape data, visualize, and then show my results online. So the first thing I was curious about is, how often are women on the cover of Sports Illustrated but not in swimsuits? Second thing, how do sciences compare in their percentages of women and racial ethnic groups? How has Pixar movie success changed over time? And can someone remind me how all of the senators voted on all of those different healthcare repeals? Anyway, so the workforce package again is going to be ggplot2 for everything. All right, so let's get to the first thing. How often are women on the cover of Sports Illustrated and not in swimsuits? This is an example of one woman who's in a swimsuit and one woman who's not, in case that wasn't clear. And I became curious about this because if anyone watches John Oliver, he did a "How is this still a thing?" piece on the swimsuit issue. And after he did that, I was thinking to myself, man, is it true that most of the time that I see a woman on the cover, it's one of the swimsuit models? I'm not sure. So this is an example of a case where there was no existent data on this. Sports Illustrated does have their archive of covers, but they don't keep metadata on like who's on the cover. So I was like, this is gonna be my day now of collecting all of this. And I was like, no one has done this, so I will do this. I'll take one for the team. But you can all find this now. So I looked through 487 covers over 5 years. There's often multiple covers for the same week, so don't be disturbed by why is that number so big. And I counted up basically male athletes, coaches, other miscellaneous guys, female athletes, coaches, female swimsuit models, miscellaneous women, and then covers that are just text or just a helmet or something that isn't a person. And I was very generous with these counts. There's one where there's two women crouching in cheerleader costumes like this next to a guy, and I counted that as a female cover. So that's like in here as a woman, even though it's the man is in the center, obviously, being the star. Anyway, just a side note for everyone. All right, so now I have these counts. How do I want to visualize this? So this is where we're thinking about, like what you were talking about earlier today, how do you think about now taking your idea and putting it into some shape? So like rectangling or whatever we were saying for your idea. So I wanted to show the cover distribution over each year, but also the full 5-year distribution. I also cared about, imagine you're just looking at the female covers. So this is what I got. So you have 2010 to 2014 on the top year by year, you have the total distribution. There's a lot of gray. Gray is the male athletes, coaches, you guys. So 2.67% of these 5 years of covers had female athletes or coaches on them. And then when you were just looking within the female covers, 52% were athletes or coaches. So you had like a 50-50 shot of picking a cover that had a woman on it and getting actually a female athlete or coach rather than a miscellaneous kind of prop woman or a swimsuit model. So in terms of talking about how to do this in R, I used a multiplot function to combine 4 different graphs. You could also have used grid arrange to combine them. And then it's basically geome bar and filling based on the kind of cover, and the cover is the that was the data that I obviously had collected issue by issue. So, but there was something good that happened after I did this in 2015, you guys, don't be too sad, where Sports Illustrated released all these different covers to celebrate the World Cup winning US women's soccer team. So there's these 25 female covers all of a sudden in 2015. So you can see that big patch of blue over there, and then check out those numbers on the bottom, 2015, all of a sudden. Like there's way more than there had been in all 5 years combined. And a difference aesthetically is that previously I was using GG Themes theme Tufty, and now I kind of have my own custom plot for this custom theme. All right, great, so that was our first topic. Now we're gonna shift gears. We're still, instead of talking about a Sports Illustrated magazine, we're gonna talk about the sciences. So I got curious about this because I'm in economics, which is a social science. NSF has data on all of these different sciences, and they have a data portal where they keep all this. And at the time, the most recent I could find was 2012. And the first thing that I was curious about is comparing female representation for undergrad and doctoral levels. So what does that look like? Here's your answer. Psych is most female, and then you have econ, my discipline, much closer to CS and physics than you do to the other social sciences, for instance. And in terms of how I was interested in showing this, I wanted to show each discipline, but I also wanted to show their parent science category. So the coloring is this parent category, which is like social science, for instance. So all the gray is social science. All of the pink is earth, atmospheric, ocean sciences, which get grouped together by the NSF too. And a really useful command also that I learned through doing this was geome label repel, because if you've ever taken labels and tried to manually move them around, it's a nightmare. It turns out there's something for that, so this is something that I learned at that point. The next thing that I'm gonna talk to you guys about is racial and ethnic representation. So in this case, instead of just looking at 2012, I look from 2002 to 2012. And I try plotting this out using 3 different methods, and we discuss which one is the most useful or which one you guys like the most. I couldn't really decide, so I ended up sharing all of them. What I really like about this project is they allow me to try out facet wrapping, which is, you know, when you have like a specific plot for, in this case, each discipline, so each type of science in this case. So here's your area stacked graph. So you can see changes over time, and each one of these is a discipline. it's a little bit small for you guys because there are so many sciences. This one is the Nightingale version, which someone told me looks like different stages of dilated pupils, which, and I think they're actually right. And if you care about what the colors are, you know, it's really hard to tell for some of the smaller areas here. But black is white for US and permanent residents, and then red is a category for temporary residents. So econ, for instance, is always the discipline with the highest percentage of temporary residents. Meanwhile, psychology is very dilated because it's a pretty white discipline. If you care about the trends, though, I would argue that these guys aren't really what you want to look at because you're looking at things stacked on top of each other, and maybe what you want to do is just go to the simple line chart. So this is what that's showing. And there's a lot of movement in, say, history of science because they don't have that many people each year who study that, so it moves around a lot. And here's another little code snippet on that. And now we go to Pixar. So, I don't know whether you guys remember Inside Out. I really loved that movie. And when I saw it, I was also very impressed with the fact that Pixar was, in my mind, like returning to a higher quality level after I'd been seeing ads for like Cars 2 and had been disturbed by what had happened to Pixar. So, I was curious how we could try to visualize the success of Pixar films over time. You know, we care about things like public perception, awards, critical acclaim, and dollar sign, money. And I'm going to focus on some of the most salient metrics, in my opinion. You could also do this with different things, like instead of Rotten Tomatoes, we do Metacritic or IMDb. That's also something that I tried out. And then in terms of awards, Oscars, and in terms of money, opening weekend gross, but you could also do full. At the time that I did this, Inside Out wasn't done showing, so I chose opening weekend gross. And how can you show all three of these things at the same time? Well, the way I chose to do this was using a bubble chart, which basically means that you're going to do a scatter plot in one way. So scatter plot basically for the Rotten Tomatoes, but then scaling based on the money that they made. And then just coloring based on Oscar, because Oscar is very much, did you win one? Did you not win one? Or was it not applicable because they didn't really get the category going until you had already made a bunch of awesome films and they were like, we should give you an award, so we should make this award a thing. So basically what you can see here is that Inside Out was this return to BC2 reviews before Cars 2 review levels. And this is what we would call a bubble chart because you're scaling the actual points based on another variable that you have. Also, this is a project that when I put on Reddit, someone found a mistake, which is a great reason to share your work because I had been scaling the points by, I had been putting the numbers to the radii, which then makes it certain things look way bigger than they should because your eyes care about area, they don't care about the radius of a circle. So you don't want things to be scaling up non-linearly like that. So for this reason, you want to use scale size area if you're ever doing this. All right. So we are now going to get to our last question. I'm sure you guys remember this summer, there was a week where if you were following the news, there were just tons of these Obamacare repeal votes. And if you were me, you know, you could follow the Times and see the grid write-up that they had of how everyone voted. But it was very hard to really remember the full picture of how that looked. So something that I wanted to do was actually take the Times data and then show it geographically. So this is now another case where I'll get to use faceting, because we love faceting. So this is the vote to begin debate. Basically, the idea here was that for each state, you have two senators, except for sad little DC, who has an emoji with a zipper, because no voice in government. And basically, coloring is such that blue is Democrat who said no. Oh, that was the only Democrat vote. Republican could say no or yes. No is this purple in between red and blue, obviously. And red was Republican voting yes. So you can see this was the first vote that we had to begin debate. And basically what we're doing here is we're using the GeoFacet package to make these tile grid maps. Each of the different states is basically made of two color columns, and then you're just coding the color of the column based on what you had inputted about whether they voted yes or no, and whether they're a Republican or a Democrat. So it was an identity plus vote variable. Also, it's a great way to use the magic package, which should always get a lot of plugging because it's great. Image read and image composite allow you to bring images into each other, put them together, and that was how I put that little emoji on DC, which is a tiny addition, but it allowed me to be introduced to this package, which you should definitely look up if you haven't used before. So now I'm just gonna quickly flip through the three votes that ended up falling. So this was the repeal and replace. This was the partial repeal amendment on Wednesday, so the day after the Tuesday, where they voted to begin debate and voted down repeal and replace. And then the last thing was the skinny repeal amendment, which is probably what everyone remembers the best, because this was the really dramatic three votes. So you end up, so this was on Friday at the end of the week. So the basic idea in this project was, I mean, first of all, getting to use Facet Geo is really fun, but also the idea was that you have a news story that's just so packed with information, is there some way that you could distill it down so that you could perhaps grasp the summary more quickly? So if you want more access to any code or data sets, you can find everything on thelittledataset.com, which is where I keep everything. There's GitHub repos for everything, and there's our pubs page that I keep that has a lot of the notebooks. So I'm now gonna take the last few minutes to talk a little bit about workflow that I use and that I think can be helpful to suggest to others. So for coming up with how you want to think of projects, this is the ideation stage. Writing down questions that pop into your head is awesome. Thinking about how you could answer them with data and making sure to always bother all of your friends with all of your ideas is great. You just slip it into conversation and see if they seem interested in the answer. And if they're not, then maybe it's not that interesting. But if they do seem interested, then maybe you should keep going with it. So it's a nice discrete way of testing out your ideas. Another way that you can go about this is you can actually start with fun data sets rather than starting with questions. So if you guys aren't aware of this amazing newsletter called Data is Plural, it's run by this great guy who's at BuzzFeed. He basically sends out these amazing data sets that are sometimes just really fun to look through and will often prompt cool questions in your head. And then reading the news and thinking about stories that that could perhaps be more succinctly visually communicated. In terms of our practices, obviously using notebooks is awesome. I love it personally because you can narrate to other people what you're doing, but also no one should underestimate how hard it is for your future self to remember what you were doing at any given moment. Like, you have a lot of future selves who won't be as in this as you were at that given moment. And so it's good for also communicating across time within even just yourself. So here's some snippets of notebooks that I used for the Senate vote maps, for instance. And you can see that code can be separated so easily from narration and comments. You can have these sections and chronology of thought process and keep your workflow really clear and the visualizations come right along. So I really love this as a way to show people how you're getting where you're going and to making your work a lot more replicable, accessible, understandable to really anyone. Even if they don't know how to use R, they can read each section and say, okay, this piece must have been doing what it just said below it. In terms of writing your code, obviously using Stack Overflow's resource is amazing. You often will read answers to questions where you learn more than just the answer to the question you were looking up. Finding examples of code from other people is also a great way to go, which you can do when you're on the RStats Twitter, obviously. And yeah, people also will often love talking to you about their work, so. Last thing that I wanted to say was that sharing your work is also really great. I want a plug for making reproducible and accessible work. As someone who's currently in academia, I think that that's something that we could do a lot better, and I think that that's something that's really important. I also think that making work more replicable and accessible is also really important for like bringing in a broader group of people to the R community and to a lot of coding communities in general. Reminding people that it doesn't just have to be about, it can be about whatever you're interested in. So showing people the vast number of questions that you could be answering or things that you could be curious about that could be relevant to this is, I think, really empowering for a lot of people. Also, it lets people check your work, which is great. And it's super satisfying. So basically, the thesis of what I wanted to say is that I think channeling your curiosity into data viz projects is a great way to get comfortable with R. It's exciting and effective, and I love doing that, and I would love to hear from you guys if you have any curious questions for me.
Great presentation, Alex. Any questions?
For the Pixar analysis, did you have to do like web scraping, like for stuff like Rotten Tomatoes and the Oscar stuff, or is there actually like an API for that stuff?
So for the Pixar stuff, because all I was looking at was the Rotten Tomatoes score at that time that I was pulling it, I didn't even have to. I just like broke them down. So it was because at that point, I'm just taking down however many values, so I didn't like bother with that. So these are the scores at the time that I made this, obviously. So another way of doing this that would have been like more advanced would be to, you know, have it actually consistently pulling those numbers. That was at the time that I made this, like it's just a static thing that captured the values at the time of I guess this was 2015 in July or something like that.
There's a wrap.
There's
a Rotten Tomatoes wrapper, like
WRAPP.
Yeah. Also, you could just call straight from that.
Yeah, it wraps the API.
See, these are the things you learn when you share your work. Yeah.
And also, as a parent of a toddler, Cars 2 is amazing.
Oh, really? I mean, it may
be. Well, no, it's amazing if you're occupied while daddy cleans other stuff.
Got it, yeah. No, don't worry. It doesn't mean anything that they like that dot down there. It's fine. Also, it's truncated, so, you know, it would have 40%. It wasn't zero, but, you know, 40.
Okay.
Yes?
I was going to ask the same thing about the New York Times data.
Yeah, so the New York Times data was, I have no idea how I would have pulled that, if anyone has any idea. It was basically like this article where they had here, let me show you. These were, like, just images. So I didn't even know how to like pull the, I wouldn't have been able to pull the like Y's and the N's because it was just an image. But maybe there was a better way of doing that rather than, again, me like going, making my fingers bleed.
There's a Vodiogram package now.
Look at this. There's all these packages.
By Bob Grugis. Sometimes if I want a package, I just go to like
/HarperMaster/what I want. Yeah.
Yeah, there's a Vodiogram package.
Do they have the for each person?
Yeah.
That's awesome.
And actually, you just need a, like it auto maps now to a grid.
No way, that's so
but
cool.
But that's, it's new. It's
yeah,
like,
okay,
did
cool.
All that.
No, I mean, this has happened before. I remember one time I figured out how to do a chloroplast map. Not the tile grid type, but just like the actual shape one. And I spent so long figuring out how to do it. And then a week later, Nathan Yao, if you guys know him, Flowing Data, put out this little thing about, hey guys, if you've ever been having trouble with Alaska and Hawaii and getting them in there, here you go. And I was like, Nathan, why didn't you do this 2 weeks earlier? Would have saved me a lot. But that's awesome that that's a package. So yeah, I think in a lot of these cases, there's a better way to collect the data, but sometimes I just didn't know.
I also did that.
Yeah. There you go. Yeah. You feel my pain.
It does seem that's the energy of inertia. I mean, you can come up with a really lot of cool questions,
mm-hmm.
right? And you've got some great tools, but it's finding the data
mm-hmm.
that's really the energy of inertia and the time sink, right?
Yeah.
So
I think that's true.
You know, I don't know, we got Stack Overflow for questions, but where do you go to, like, you know, you just network here, you find out all these cool places,
yeah.
but, it, you know, where do you go to find
yeah.
a centralized location of what you're looking for?
Yeah, I think that in a lot of cases, I'm in the camp of I have the question and then I look for the data, but there are a lot of people, I think, who go the other way around, where they find the really awesome data set, and then those people don't have the same problem, so it's interesting, because, like, I think that those people sometimes end up being frustrated that they can't answer the question they want to. Meanwhile, I become frustrated often with just the like data collection process and some of the like munging and cleaning stuff. So I think that like it is really hard to find always what you want. And I end up often, like I hope I don't brute force like this all the time for collecting. And I often work with much larger data sets where that it exists in a more systematic way. But it's really cool to, you know that there's more things in the R universe that you could be looking for. And I think there's a lot of people, I think something to learn from this is that there's so many people who have knowledge of all these different sectors of the world. And just putting out your question and trying to like ask around is often useful to do before you collect it yourself, because you might sink time that you didn't have to.
Yeah, being in economics, have you ever found any like pushback at all using R versus Stata?
Actually, no. So I think a lot of people use Stata because other people use Stata. So if you're going to extend a project that already exists in Stata, you might just use Stata because you're building off of that. It could be really hard to reinvent the wheel and start again. But if you're starting something fresh, when you show someone an R notebook, like I did this summer with a professor of mine, I was doing this project with him and I was like, I want to rebuild everything because I think it looks like crap right now. And here, look at this notebook. And he's like, I've never seen anything like this. What do you mean it runs and it creates the pictures in there? And I was like, this is the revolution. So I think the dream is that the paper is, you eventually just write your whole paper in like a notebook, in a markdown format, and then everything's there and someone who wants to look at actually how you got there looks at the markdown file instead of the generated media.
Sorry. Please.
I'll ask later.
Okay, yeah.
Okay, I was gonna ask a question actually, but so you can ask.
Oh. Since you've started a blog, and do you have any tips on people who have thought about sharing the work in a blog format?
Yeah, so I would suggest that you, first of all, I would suggest that you use Blogdown when you do it. And like, it's an amazing tool for you to, so in terms of how you do it, I would suggest like you do everything in R. If I could redo the process, that's what I would have done. Also, I suggest that like, you know, when you come up with something that you're proud of, like sharing it to your friends or sharing it on Reddit also it's dangerous, but sometimes good things happen, like people will help you in some way because they're excited about, especially like Data is Beautiful is a place where I will always put stuff. And sometimes people find mistakes and make corrections, which is like really helpful. And it also gets people talking to each other about your work. So there's a cool ecosystem out there where you can often share and get people looking at it. And I think that then energizes or empowers you to do it more. Because you like, I mean, no matter what, like doing something in isolation, it's hard to feel connected to other people or like, should I really do this more? When you have other people saying, oh, that was interesting, let me hear more, then you end up also then working at a faster pace, which I think is important to have something pushing you forward.
Great. Okay, let's stop there. If you've got any more questions for Alex like I have, then catch you later on. But thank you, Alex, that was great.